tune in to BBC Radio Scotland later tonight to hear more. Julia Gillard and Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala have some strong ideas about the impact of gender on the treatment of leaders, which they explore in their new book, Women and Leadership. It highlights some of the barriers facing women in senior positions in politics and other industries. As the former Prime Minister of Australia, Julia faced sexism on a daily basis, including from other politicians in Parliament. Here's a clip of what has become known as the misogyny speech, which she gave in 2012, directed at the then leader of the opposition, Tony Abbott. And I should warn you, there's some strong language, so if you have younger ears listening, you might want to turn the volume down for the next minute.
I was offended too by the sexism, by the misogyny of the Leader of the Opposition catcalling across this table at me as I sit here as Prime Minister. If the Prime Minister wants to, politically speaking, make an honest woman of herself, something that would never have been said to any man sitting in this chair. I was offended when the Leader of the Opposition went outside in the front of Parliament and stood next to a sign that said, "Ditch the witch." I was offended when the Leader of the Opposition stood next to a sign that described me as a man's bitch. I was offended by those things. Misogyny, sexism, every day from this Leader of the Opposition.
Well, I'm joined now by three women who are in senior positions in their own fields. Kezia Dugdale, director of the John Smith Centre for Public Service at the University of Glasgow and former leader of the Scottish Labour Party. We have Emma Jackson, national director of Christians Against Poverty in Scotland. A warm welcome to you both.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And still with us is Mary Kidd, writer and head of literature, languages and publishing at Creative Scotland. Kezia, first of all, this book largely looks at the experience of senior female politicians. Would you say that some of the barriers they described held true for you?
Oh, and undoubtedly so, Cathy, and good morning. What a privilege it is to be able to be on your programme this morning and to talk about this amazing book. How I wish somebody had given me a copy of it 10 years ago. And the truth is, really, there are so many wonderful books about the challenges that women face in public life or the barriers of misogyny and sexism that they have to overcome. But what makes this book different is it has practical solutions. So it identifies 8 key problems that prominent women have always faced. It talks about it from the perspectives of leading women like Jacinda Ardern and Hillary Clinton, and then crucially offers up some advice for the next generation of women about how they can short circuit these problems so they don't have to go through the same experiences or learn from the mistakes that they perhaps made the first time around when they faced it. It's a wonderful read.
Now, do you think the sexism may not be as blatant as it was in that clip of speech we just heard? Is there less of it, or is it just that it takes on a very different hue?
I think it's much harder, certainly in Scottish politics, as I've seen it, to identify the type of example you've just seen there between Julia Gillard and Tony Abbott. But what there is in Scottish politics and across UK politics is a more kind of inherent sexism. It's written in, it's priced into scenarios, it's darker and harder to identify and therefore harder to overcome. So it's absolutely there, and you don't have to be called a witch across the dispatch box for it to be there in your working life.
Emma, you lead a national charity and you're the mother of 3 children. New Zealand Premier Jacinda Ardern is one of the women interviewed in the book, and she talks about managing family and working life. And she actually says we shouldn't try to be superhuman and pretend it's easy. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, good morning, Cathy. Yeah, I think I absolutely do agree with that. There is this expectation, if you're in a senior leadership role as a woman and you do have a family, that you can do it all. You can be all of the things to all of the people. And there is this pressure, either explicit or subconscious, that you need to be at the top of your game. You need to be seen to be able to spin all of the plates and do all of the things. And as Jacinda Ardern rightly says, that's impossible. You know, it's not possible to do those things. And actually what's really important is that we have the courage and the boldness to kind of be vulnerable in our spaces as female leaders and to talk about the difficulties that exist and the structures that need to change that could make these things easier for us as female leaders. As you said, I have 3 young children myself, and Spinning the plates and the juggle has been something that I've encountered a lot. But as I suppose as I've got older and matured a little bit, I'm much more willing to talk about that more openly and create a space where we can have a dialogue about this so that we can see change happen.
It is that. It's a courage to actually address something and to admit. It's not about defeat. It's about demystifying the process of bringing up children or whatever the personal commitments are. There are other Absolutely. Family dynamics, whether it's looking after older family members. And perhaps in a sense, it's been partly fear that's held some women back. Fear of appearing to fail.
Absolutely. As I do look back on my own career, I think that was a fear that I definitely held in younger years. We had three children very close together. So I had three small children all together. And it was something that I felt that I just needed to be seen to be winning and able to do well. And like you say, different women have different caring responsibilities, be that children, be that parents. There's a whole range of things that we can have in our personal life. And we need to have the courage to speak about it. Vulnerability, I think, is an incredibly important thing as leaders across the board, irrespective of your gender, but to have the vulnerability to talk about these things. And for myself, as a leader in a charity, I'm really passionate about creating the culture that I want to see, where we talk more openly about this, where we share our stories and we work collaboratively to find solutions.
Mari, one of the key issues faced by women is that they are judged differently to men. Is there a pressure to constantly examine your behaviour so you're not perceived in a certain way?
I think absolutely. But I think that a point Heather made earlier on the programme is that also we as women are our harshest critics. And there was an infamous study from Hewlett-Packard which said that men would apply for a role if they fulfilled approximately 50% of the criteria, and women yeah. wouldn't go for it unless they fulfilled 100. And it's interesting there, because just that very point about the fear of failure, we judge ourselves most harshly, and then we are judged more harshly, and we're judged on a lot of nonsense, such as, you know, the point is made in the book that I don't think any of us could stand up looking like Boris Johnson, sort of as though we'd rolled out of bed and perhaps not even brushed our hair. That these things are very, and we are, women are our judges of other women. But fundamentally, it all boils down to something structural and something that is so absolutely kind of difficult to challenge because it's pernicious. But on the other hand, as Kezia says, I think in Scotland our culture, politically certainly, is that there wouldn't be signs such as Julia had to stand beside. But equally, if you look at the absolute abyss of abuse happening on social media, where individuals feel absolutely free to publish the most abusive, violent, threatening content about women and not about men, there is something deeply wrong there.
Stepping back just one step, Kezia, and staying with not just what women look like, but their behaviour too. Did you feel the pressure as a relatively young party leader in the Scottish Parliament to behave in a certain way too?
Yes, unquestionably so. And there's a chapter kind of addressing this in the book about whether women should define themselves as either shrill or soft, that political leaders can only be one or the other. Shrill in your written off is kind of reacting too quickly with the high-pitched voice and getting too easily angered. And if you're too soft and you show too much empathy and too much sensitivity, then suddenly you're not strong enough or can't carry yourself with the degree of authority that people expect of their politicians, because all they've ever seen is men behave in such a way. And I mean, I find that so true. And, you know, the book concludes talking about this role model riddle. And I see this all the time in the job I'm doing now at the John Smith Centre, is on the one hand, people who've been at a high level in politics trying to encourage the next generation, if they say to women, oh, it's really easy, you'll be great at it, go for it, the women hearing that think that sounds like you're the exception to the rule, and that's just because you know, you're so talented or you're so good. But the flip side is, if you tell them the truth and say, yes, it's really hard, it's really challenging, then you might put people off. So it's about trying to find the space where you can do both of those things and say, yes, it's hard, but it's so worth it. You know, to stand for elected office, to be in a position to change the laws of your country is a wonderful wonderful thing. We should encourage more women towards it.